Good morning and welcome to the first meeting of the This morning we will take evidence from the Scottish Government on the latest ministerial statements on COVID-19. I'd like to welcome to the meeting John Swinney, Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for COVID Recovery, Professor Jason Leach, National Clinical Director, Penelope Cooper, Director of COVID Coordination, and Niamh O'Connor, Deputy Director for Testing and Contact Tracing Policy. Thank you for your attendance this morning, and I wish you all a happy new year, and I hope you manage to have some sort of break over the festive period. Deputy First Minister, would you like to make any remarks before we move on to questions?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. I'm grateful to the committee for the opportunity to discuss a number of matters, including updates to Parliament on COVID-19, and to make some opening remarks before taking questions. As set out by the First Minister on Tuesday, while Omicron is continuing to cause extremely high levels of new cases, we must remain careful. There are grounds for cautious optimism that our current additional measures and the efforts being made by people across Scotland are having an impact. Last month, our central projection was that new infections could reach 50,000 a day by early January. So far, this has not materialised, and we estimate that the total number of daily infections may be around 30,000. We're also seeing the number of cases confirmed by PCR tests have fallen in all age groups except the over 85s. This is encouraging and gives us some hope that cases might be at or close to the peak. Further, although the number of people in hospital with COVID has continued to increase over the past week, there are signs that the rate of increase may be starting to slow. In line with our guidance set out last week, people with symptoms who test positive with a lateral flow test no longer need to secure a confirmatory PCR test. This means that the current daily numbers are capturing fewer positive cases than before. To address this, Public Health Scotland will, from today, augment its daily reports to include the combined figure for the number of people who have recorded a first positive PCR or lateral flow test. This additional data will allow us to assess the trend in cases more accurately. I encourage members of the public to continue recording their lateral flow results, whether they are positive or negative. This can be done very easily through the UK Government website, under the report a lateral flow test search approach. While we must remain careful and cautious, Cabinet agreed on Tuesday to begin lifting the additional protective measures that were introduced before Christmas. We will do so in a phased manner and further dates will be announced in due course. From Monday the 17th of January, the attendance limits on large-scale outdoor events will be removed. Certification will remain in place for events and venues previously covered by the scheme, and we are asking event organisers to check the certification status of more people attending events. From Monday, for the purposes of certification, the requirement to be fully vaccinated will include having a booster if the second dose was more than 4 months ago. For the time being, baseline measures that were in place before the emergence of Omicron, such as wearing face coverings in indoor places and working from home where possible, will remain in place. For the immediate period ahead, our advice remains that people should limit their contact with other households and, in particular, not meet indoors with more than 3 households. We are not asking people to cut all social interaction, but reducing contacts and prioritising who we meet with will help to reduce the risk. Our advice remains to take a lateral flow test and report the result when meeting others. Finally, the First Minister confirmed that the Scottish Government intends to publish a revised strategic framework in the next few weeks. I will update the committee further once this has been published, and I'm happy, Convener, to answer any questions the committee may have this morning.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. I will turn to questions, and if I may begin by asking the first question. I think we're all cautiously thankful that Omicron isn't as severe as we first expected when it emerged in early December. With the schools going back in the last week, I really wanted to ask about the effect of Omicron on children, on our school children, and especially as most of them have not been vaccinated, and maybe an update on vaccinations for the 5 to 12-year-olds, and just in the school settings, is ventilation adequate at the moment as the schools have gone back?
Obviously, we We'll be monitoring very carefully, convener, the impact of schools returning, and that is central to the approach the government is taking, because we recognise that the schools returning marks a gathering of individuals within our society at a fairly high level. And as we know with COVID, the meeting of individuals from multiple households that leads to spread of the virus. So we will be monitoring that data very closely. That's why we're taking a phased approach to the relaxation of restrictions, because although the data at the present moment is encouraging, that could be influenced by the effect of schools returning, and we will only now just be beginning to see the effects of that in the numbers to the extent that that will have an effect. In relation to the questions on vaccination of our younger citizens, we do not have the authorisation for widespread vaccination of children in the 5 to 12 age group from the JCVI. The case has not been made for that by the JCVI, and as the committee will be familiar, we look to and take forward the advice of the JCVI. Obviously, in relation to some children, the JCVI have indicated that it is appropriate for vaccination to take place, particularly where a child may be of themselves clinically vulnerable, or living in a household with individuals who are clinically vulnerable, and we are obviously taking steps to implement those recommendations, as has been confirmed to Parliament. In relation to the last part of your question, convener, on ventilation, this is ostensibly a local authority priority. We have been engaging with local authorities over the course of the last 20 months on the issues of ventilation, and have made requirements of local authorities to enhance the monitoring of air quality within schools, to first of all ensure that we have a good understanding of where some of the ventilation requirements may need to be in place. And of course, on Tuesday, the First Minister announced some further expansion of the funding available to local authorities to enhance ventilation schemes, should that be a requirement. I'd also point out that local authorities have undertaken extensive audits of the on a classroom by classroom basis about the ventilation requirements, and we would expect local authorities to act accordingly to address any ventilation weakness that emerges out of those surveys.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. If I could just ask one more question, just given that we do know that our NHS at the moment is under a lot of pressure, and we always knew it would be, but in light of some of the NHS boards calling in military help and declaring major incidents, can the Cabinet Secretary provide the committee with a rundown of the position of the other NHS boards?
There is a huge amount of pressure on NHS boards around the country. I think it would be fair to say that all boards are under intense pressure. They are having to manage high demand for services, along with some of the difficulties of staff absence, which is caused by Omicron of itself, and obviously the changes to testing arrangements and isolation periods which the government has implemented will be beginning to have a welcome effect on easing some of those staffing pressures. We are confident about the sustainability of NHS services at this moment, but I have to say that that is a constantly dynamic position. The individual hospitals will come under greater pressure as a consequence of incidents that take place and demand that presents itself. And of course, across the National Health Service, we are circulating and issuing advice, encouraging people to use the appropriate health services for the circumstances that they face. So at this stage, I would say that the National Health Service in all parts of the country is coping, but it's coping under enormous pressure, and the headroom that's available to deal with increased demand is very, very limited. For that reason, I have been leading, along with the Health Secretary and the Social Justice Secretary, dialogue with local government about expanding the capacity of social care services around the country, because obviously the more we can have in place effective social care services within the community, the more we can support individuals to have their needs met at home and on other care settings, avoid them presenting in NHS facilities. And that is one of the crucial interventions that we are making to try to stem demand pressure on the National Health Service.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister, that your update is appreciated. Could I move on to other members now? And if I could bring in Murdo Fraser, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the Cabinet Secretary and colleagues. I'd like to ask a couple of different issues this morning, if there's time. And I'd like to start off by raising again an issue I've raised previously, which is the question of data. We've been trying to pursue this question of understanding, in terms of hospital admissions, how many of those admitted to hospital are there because COVID is the primary cause of their admission, as opposed to it being secondary or incidental. And we saw some limited data being published on Friday from Public Health Scotland based on two health boards. But I wonder when we might have a fuller picture, because I think that's actually really important in terms of understanding the true impact of Omicron on the health service. The second issue is around the question of vaccinations. How many of those in hospital because of COVID, and in particular in intensive care units, are vaccinated as opposed to unvaccinated? And thirdly, has there been anyone as yet who has died that we're aware of as a result of the Omicron variant? Now, I don't know if the Scottish Government has this information, but it's not been shared with us or with the public. So I'd be interested to know if that data is actually being collected.
I'll draw on some contributions from Professor Jason Leach in relation to some of this material, but let me work my way through the different points that Mr. Fraser raised. First of all, on the issue of the reasons for hospitalisation for individuals, whether it's because of COVID or people admitted with COVID or people who are in hospital with COVID. The data has been developed by Public Health Scotland, working on data sets from Greater Glasgow and Clyde Health Board and NHS Grampian. These are two very significant boards, NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde, the largest board in the country, which covers a very substantial share of the population. So I think we have to get into a proper perspective the scale of the country that is covered by the data from that was the subject of release. It would just be last week, I assume, if my recollection is correct. Yes, it will be. And that does give us a fairly substantial picture around the country, and it demonstrates a pattern, which is that about 60% of people who are being admitted to hospital in connection with COVID are being admitted because of COVID. That's a relatively similar number to the number in the studies that have been produced in other nations in the United Kingdom. It's also not that dissimilar to the position with earlier strains of the virus. My recollection is correct that the previous data in the exercise published by Public Health Scotland was that 68% in the previous survey that was undertaken had been admitted to hospital because of COVID. And I think that I think in the context of the volume of data that we publish on these questions, I think the data that has been published on this issue gives us, I think, a pretty good understanding of the balance and the breakdown of that information. And obviously, Public Health Scotland will be working on further iterations of that data in due course. On the second point, in relation to the position on vaccinated and unvaccinated individuals in hospital. From the latest data that I have seen, the analysis showed that the unvaccinated hospitalisation rate was 59 out of 100,000, while the boosted hospitalisation rate was 15 out of 100,000, meaning that the unvaccinated are four times more likely to be hospitalised than people who have had their booster or third dose. So I hope that data helps, but I'll obviously I'll draw on the input from Professor Leach in the further detail that you'll provide on that answer.
Can I bring in Professor Jason Leach, please?
Yeah, morning, everybody. Morning, convener, and a happy new year to everybody. Your questions are good, Mr. Fraser. Let me deal with them in simplicity order. I'll come to the harder one last. The vaccination status of hospitalisations and deaths are published every week. I actually don't know why there's too much fuss in finding them from individuals. It was most recently published yesterday by Public Health Scotland. Mr. Swinney has read out one of the elements of it, 59 versus 15. There's also mortality rates in that same publication. They were published the week before. And each of those publications shows the previous 4 weeks, but they divide them into 7 days. So the mortality rate, and forgive the kind of callous way of talking about mortality rates, I understand absolutely that these are real people with families who have had to grieve even over the Christmas and New Year period because of this horrible disease. But the unvaccinated mortality rate was 4.79 per 100K, and the boosted mortality rate was 0.21 per 100K. It once again confirms, if we needed it confirmed again, that the best protection you can have is your booster dose. Well, these data are being replicated globally. Now, bear in mind, if you just look at the raw numbers of deaths, you may come to a different conclusion. But that's because the vast majority of the country are boosted. So you have to age adjust and make it rates in order to understand the difference the booster rate is having. Now, those numbers vary a little bit from week to week because the numbers are quite low. Your key question about whether these people die of Omicron or not, I'm afraid, is not straightforward to answer. The over 92% now of every positive case in Scotland is Omicron. So we have no reason to believe that it's a continuing big Delta wave, but we probably still have some stragglers coming through the system who will have Delta. So it's not absolutely certain that these deaths are Omicron, but I am anticipating, as is the rest of the research community, that Omicron does lead to some deaths, particularly in the unvaccinated. We're learning more and more about risk, and I think I've said to this committee before, we now know the principal risk is immunity. Whether your immunity is hampered by disease, so a transplant, HIV, something else going on with your leukemia or something, those are the big risk factors now. And age, because as you age, your immunity diminishes. That's why vaccination is such a big solution. The intensive care data is harder to get than the hospitalisation data and the death data, just because of the nature of data collection and the small numbers of people who end up in intensive care. So we rely on a slightly different mechanism called the Scottish Intensive Care Audit Group. They're about to publish their most recent data, I think, in the next 2 weeks. But the last one they did was you were six times less likely to be in intensive care if you were vaccinated. That's the headline. You're six times less likely to be in intensive care if you're vaccinated. They will redo that data now for boosters and for Omicron, and I look forward to seeing their conclusion. But the global data says around six times less likely. Let me come to your slightly harder point that we've covered here before, and Mr. Swinney covered it, and that is in with COVID or because of COVID. I don't know what the fascination with this data is. I mean, you have all the data we have. We've published everything that I've got around this question, but it speaks to a, if you'll forgive me, a slight misunderstanding of how healthcare works. Healthcare is not a single disease. The people in hospital with COVID who are in trouble don't just have COVID. They have diabetes, they have leukemia, they're 87, they are all kinds of things going on. So the death certificates often have five reasons for death, not one. And principal diagnosis versus secondary diagnosis is a matter of judgment at the time of death by the junior doctor who perhaps is filling in the death certificate. So by all means, you can get all the data we have, and you have it, I promise. But I am not as convinced that this data is as important as perhaps some think, because healthcare is not linear. There are very few people in who are having their leg fixed because they fell over in the ice who get a positive COVID test. There will be some, of course, but the vast majority getting care in our hospitals with a COVID test are getting it because they've got COVID and they've got other things going on as well.
Okay, can I, Mr. Fraser, I will bring you back in for a brief supplementary, but can I ask for the answers to be brief, because I really have to.
Thank you, Convener, and thanks to Professor Leach for a very, very detailed and comprehensive response. And I'll just make a point very briefly. I mean, the reason I'm asking these questions is I've been asking these questions for some weeks now, and it's been really hard to get as clear an explanation as we've just had as to the numbers. And specifically on this question of the difference in hospitalisation between vaccinated and unvaccinated, I just ask whether the Scottish Government should be doing more to put that message out to the public, because, you know, we're all wanting to encourage people more and more to get vaccinated and get boosted. And I think if it was as clear as you have just stated about the statistics, and that was more widely known amongst the public, that would be a really helpful message to get out.
I think that's fair, and I agree. I think Mr. Swinney will say the same.
Well, to me, these messages are communicated by government, and, you know, our clinical advisers have been to the forefront of arguing for the rationale for vaccination and the booster program, and ministers likewise. And I think at the heart of many of the interventions we have made, whether it's been about the public communication or whether it's been about policy interventions such as vaccine certification, the purpose has been to increase the level of vaccination within the population, because it is a compelling protection against this virus. So I can assure Mr. Fraser that these messages will be communicated, or they have been communicated by ministers and will be communicated by ministers. But I think sometimes, if I can give my reflections on this, some of the endless speculation about these matters muddies the waters. I think it's been pretty crystal clear for a long time that vaccination was a critical issue as an obstacle to circulation of the to protect people against the virus. When we go through all these different issues about, you know, extra bits of data, it almost is trying to, you know, leave the public thinking that there's something that they're missing about this data, or that the government's missing about this data, when actually it's crystal clear. If you get vaccinated, you have more protection against COVID.
Okay, thank you. Alex Rowley, can we please move to you?
I mean, I would re-emphasise the point that Murphy makes. And I do think that it's important that if we have information that demonstrates that you are much better protected and those ending up in hospital are those not vaccinated, then it's important that we share that information, because the latest figures we have on vaccination, and that's where I want to focus my question on two areas. One is, our advisers have pointed out to us that in terms of the uptake of the booster, there is a tendency that it goes up with age, but when you reach the 80 plus, there is a dip. And so there seems to be a dip in the over 80s actually getting the booster. And one of the reasons for that may well be that many of these people are housebound. But one, what do you think of that? And two, what are you going to do about it? And likewise, in the SPICE document that we have, it shows that the uptake of the booster is good across the country generally, but particularly poor in the cities. I think with Glasgow at 52.6%, Edinburgh 59%, You have the islands up in the 80s, you have Fife in the 70s. So there seems to be an issue with take up. Would you acknowledge that, and what are you doing about it?
I think the obviously there's a huge amount of effort is put into securing the take up of vaccination and boosters. I was just checking, I don't have in front of me the breakdown within the over 70s category, but over 70s. Well, but the group over 70s are 95%. 95% have got boosters, so it's a
over
very
80s.
Very
over 80s, Deputy First Minister. There's a dip.
Well, I'll look at those figures specifically, but I think we've got to have a sense of context here that there's a very, very high level of vaccination undertaken at that level. Now, we obviously take a range of steps, whether it's about the prioritisation of care homes for the delivery of the vaccination programme, and again, at the outset of the approach to this, there was a bit of criticism of the Scottish Government that we weren't moving as fast as they were in England, but we were doing the painstaking work of doing the care homes to make sure that people were well vaccinated within our care homes. And I think that level has been very high. Equally, we've got to make sure that people who are housebound are vaccinated. I think from my own constituency experience, I think I certainly dealt with a number of cases where it was perhaps slower than people would have liked for housebound vaccinations to be undertaken. But my recent caseload would indicate that that is a substantially enhanced position. So I agree with Mr. Rowley on the importance of vaccination, but I think we've got to keep a sense of perspective about this, that we have very, very high levels of vaccination in these age groups. I might ask Niamh O'Connor if she wants to add anything to what I've said, or Professor Leach for that matter.
Not on vaccinations. I think Professor Leach has the request to speak in the chat box, Deputy First Minister.
Only to give the data, Deputy First Minister. Mr. Rowley, I think your premise is correct. I would give some reasons for that. The 70 to 74 is 96%. The 74 to 79 is 98%, and the over 80s is 92%. Those numbers are astonishing when you compare them globally and across the UK. The over 80s group is slightly more complex than thinking it's one homogenous group. Forgive the shorthand again, quite a lot of end-of-life care in that over 80s group who you wouldn't vaccinate, quite a lot of people in that group proportionately who you wouldn't vaccinate for a number of healthcare reasons. But you're right, if some of that group is because we haven't reached them, then we should do everything we can to do so. And I have colleagues all over the country working to do precisely that. My inbox has not got almost any cases of 80-year-old, over 80-year-olds waiting to be vaccinated. So I'm relatively confident that the health boards have found all those people and have boosted all of those people. Care homes are done. Most home visits are done. But if you have individual cases, of course, we'll be happy to do it. But don't rely entirely on the percentages, because there is good reason, particularly as you get very old, near the end of your life, where you perhaps wouldn't have your booster vaccine.
And what about the cities? Nobody's picked up on that point. As I say, Glasgow, 52% have had their vaccination. Edinburgh, a bit higher, around 59%. But there seems to be a problem in the cities compared to Fife, which is well over 70. As I say, the islands are over 80%. Is there a problem with the cities and people not getting the booster?
Obviously, the data will vary from area to area. What I'm absolutely satisfied about is that the government has and health boards have put in place adequate opportunities for individuals to secure the booster jag. I think the level of performance has been very high. We've had surplus capacity, so there've been there's been absolutely no difficulty about people getting appointments. There will obviously be, in some circumstances, a time lag that if individuals were slower in coming forward for their first and second doses, then they will obviously be delayed in getting their booster dose because of the time limits that have got to be applied. So that, you know, we're not at the end of the booster programme by any stretch of the imagination. That is continuing on an ongoing basis to vaccinate people with the appropriate gap, the 12-week gap from second dose to booster dose. So I think that probably, you know, I think the best way to explain that is that we are still in a work in progress on the booster vaccination programme, and I would expect these rates of coverage to increase. Now, we've got to continue to intensify the message. I have to say, one of the points that does concern me a little bit is that if there is a sense that Omicron is a less acute variant, that might suggest to people, well, I don't need to go forward to get my vaccination. But as Professor Leach has just explained, there is an absolute necessity for individuals to have the booster vaccination because that will give them a level of protection that is absolutely critical in dealing with the virus. So the government's messages will remain resolute about the importance of carrying out that, of rolling out that booster vaccination programme in all circumstances and in all geographies.
Finally, but given on that point, given that the vaccination in the cities are so low, is that given the government concern, and is there specific actions that you're proposing, or are you just letting it run and see if the uptake comes?
Well, we're tackling it because we have the capacity available within cities to enable people to be vaccinated. We've got headline messaging and marketing, which is encouraging people to undertake the vaccination. There have been very focused communications issued to individuals around where they've not had a booster vaccination, where we've been communicating with them directly to encourage them to do so. And the capacity will be maintained to ensure that we have opportunities for vaccination available for individuals, given the point that I just made about the fact that there may well be time gaps between the moments at which people have been vaccinated. So I assure Mr. Rowley that the government intends to maintain the messaging, the communications and the approaches to individuals, and we will maintain the capacity to ensure we can deliver the vaccination programme.
Thank you. Can I bring in Jim Fairley, please?
Thank you, convener, and welcome to the committee and to the panel, and very happy New Year to everybody. I hope you all had a nice break. Deputy Presiding Officer and Deputy First Minister, I would just like to go back to both Murdo Fraser's and Alec Rowley's point about emphasising the point about people who have been vaccinated. Are the numbers of people who have not been vaccinated who land up in hospital with real illness. One of the things that, and that's a message we have to continually get out, one of the things that I am confused about is why there is, and I think Jason Leach touched on it, this emphasis on whether people are in hospital because of COVID or with COVID. I struggle to see where the differentiation is. We've just had a clinician give us some private advice that she's having the position where people will go in, particularly elderly patients will go in with a condition. They discover that they've got COVID, but it's not until she gets to know them better and studies them that she realises that COVID is hampering their recovery. But we also have the position where people who are in hospital with COVID, whether it's affecting them or not, they still go through the process of being isolated and everything else. So I'd really like the messaging to get away from whether people are in hospital with COVID or because of COVID, because I think it really does muddy the message and it muddies the waters for us. Could you answer how we get over that position?
Well, I think I'm in a slightly a difficult position to do that, because I'm not the one making the big song and dance about that particular data, Mr. Fairley. The government has to respond to demands for information. Mr. Fraser set out to the committee this morning that he's been demanding this information for some considerable time. So the government has an obligation to address issues raised by members of parliament. Ministers have made it pretty clear that we rather take the view that you've expressed, that we don't think that there's particularly a particular significance in the difference between because of or with. We have a massive COVID challenge in our healthcare system, and the more we can do to tackle the prevalence of COVID, the more we will relieve that pressure on our healthcare system. The government's messages have been absolutely crystal clear about the dangers of COVID. We have been ensuring that there has been understanding of the severity of COVID, whether it is Omicron or not, because we cannot have a kind of relaxed attitude prevailing that somehow Omicron is not a big threat. Omicron is a massive threat to our healthcare system and to public health. And we have to get that across to people. It's why the government has been taking the strong action it's been taking to protect the public. So we are not in control of all the questions that we get asked, but what we certainly are in control of are the key messages about the importance of tackling COVID and ensuring that people, in whatever circumstance they find themselves in, and Mr. Bailey's points about the advice from your clinician are absolutely correct. If somebody has got an underlying condition and they also have COVID, their ability to deal with their underlying condition will be severely compromised by the presence of COVID. And we know that very clearly from the clinical advice that we've had.
Would Jason Leach confirm that latter point?
Yeah, yes. I'm going to argue against myself slightly here in defence of the data. There are two categories of people who are slightly different from that group, but they still require infection prevention control and it will still complicate their recovery. And that's very, very straightforward admissions. So let's say a 24-year-old with no underlying condition breaks their ankle on the ice and comes in 3 days in, tests positive for COVID. So that will still affect their recovery, could severely affect their recovery, and the hospital will still need to behave differently. And those who unfortunately still get nosocomial spread of COVID, so those in hospital who perhaps catch COVID in hospital or in an institution, which is still possible, much, much lower than it's ever been, but still possible. So those two groups, you could argue, if you kind of squint, that you would want to know those two groups separately. But in reality, you're still going to treat them for the disease, and you're going to be complicating their recovery because of COVID.
Okay, I'm very conscious of the fact that we're out of time, but my concern is that messaging is absolutely vital, and I really cannot see why we're worrying about whether people are in because of or with COVID. And given the fact that we've only got a 50% uptake in cities of the booster, we need to keep the messaging strong that we've got to get the boosters out there. Siobhan, thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Fairley. Can I bring in Brian Whittle?
Thank you, convener. Good morning, and colleagues there. I want to return to the question of data, really. A couple of points. One around data collection of non-COVID related issues. I've had a constituent, a friend of mine actually, who has unfortunately been diagnosed with stage 3 pancreatic cancer with complications, but waited 6 months to get that test. So I wonder, in terms of data, are we collecting the right data here with regards to the stage at which people are now being diagnosed with the likes of cancer compared to pre-COVID? And collecting data around how many people are being diagnosed with those kind of conditions. In fact, I presume that Professor Leach would be the best person to answer that question.
Let me say a few words just before I come to Professor Leach. I think it's absolutely critical that our healthcare system is able to meet the needs of all individuals, regardless of the health condition that they are facing, recognising the necessity of interventions where they are appropriate. So that is one of the arguments why we have got to manage and suppress the prevalence of COVID, because the more COVID cases that are in our hospitals, the less space, frankly, there is for other conditions to be addressed. And that has been a central argument that ministers have set out to this committee and to Parliament and to the public in the steps that we have taken to take what I think is appropriate and proportionate action to tackle COVID, so that our health service was able to meet the needs of all constituents, such as the individual that Mr Quittle has raised in his question, and to do that timeously, whilst we also deal with the pressures that come from COVID. So those are fundamental questions about the capacity of the health service. So I invite Professor Leach to give some more detail.
Yeah, I agree wholeheartedly with the Deputy First Minister that whatever the answer to your question is, the answer to the problem is to reduce COVID infections, which consequently will reduce pressure on hospitals and allow us to treat more cancer, bluntly. Globally, cancer is presenting later. There isn't any doubt about that, for two principal reasons. One is people were staying away because they were either told to stay away or worried about coming to hospitals everywhere in the world. So Scotland is not immune to that. And secondly, because of capacity issues. Most cancer patients don't have cancer on the referral letter. Most cancer patients are found because of some other symptom with which they are sent to a hospital. And then subsequently, after tests, after a number of visits, they are discovered to have cancer. So some of those people are on waiting lists in Cardiff and waiting lists in Edinburgh. So we have to get to them. The way to get to them is to relieve the pressure on the health service. So most of the data I have seen around the world suggests late presentation of cancer is becoming more common. I don't know exactly what that looks like in Scotland, and we won't know until we audit it over time. But I would not be remotely surprised if that is the case. And the way to fix that is to reduce COVID care and therefore increase cancer care.
Thank you, gentlemen. I think my point here is not that totally understandable, obviously, that we have a capacity issue and we only have so many people that can work within our health service at the moment, and obviously that COVID has such a significant impact in that. I think my point is around the collection of that data, the point to the future potential issues that may be coming down the line. And I'm asking this because in our last session there, a private session, we had our sort of expert clinicians suggesting that, you know, we're going to do an investigation into non-COVID related conditions, and the adequate data is not being collected to make the decisions that need to be made. And I think that's really the point I wanted to make here, is the collection of this data is so crucial and pointing to what the potential future issues that we have. I don't know who would like to speak to that.
These are absolutely legitimate points that Mr. Whittle raises. It's it does come back to some of the points I made in my earlier answer, that we must ensure that the needs of the population are met by the National Health Service. That is the fundamental founding commitment of the National Health Service, free at the point of need when individuals are in that need. And COVID obviously poses a threat to that, because it takes up capacity within our hospitals. There are over 1,500 patients in a hospital with COVID at this present moment. That's 1,500 beds that could be used for other purposes if COVID wasn't a problem for us. So the more we can get on top of COVID, the more we can reduce the circulation of the virus, the better, because it creates the space for patients such as the people on whose behalf Mr Whittle argues today, and for that matter has argued consistently for some considerable time. Now, the government has tried to take all the necessary steps to sustain the engagement of critical services that have a life-threatening impact on individuals. And we've worked very hard, clinicians have worked hard, health services have worked hard to sustain cancer services. Obviously, on acute presentations of life-threatening conditions, the health service is there to meet their needs. That's why we look very carefully at the numbers in ICU with COVID, because we have to have space in ICU for the people who are coming in because of heart attacks or brain hemorrhages or whatever it happens to be. So Mr. Whittle is right to raise these issues, and I would want to assure him and the public that the government, in its management of COVID, very much has the patient group that Mr. Whittle raises with me this morning very much in our mind to ensure their interests are protected.
Thank you for what I've made. Just one final point, hopefully forgive me for going to this place. I know a lot of our data, especially initially, pointed to the fact that the morbidity from COVID came in tandem with high levels of obesity, high levels of diabetes, and other comorbidity issues, even some of the cancers. Does this, you know, if we want to treat COVID, it kind of highlights to me that we have to look at the health in a much more holistic way. Does this not point to the fact that we need to look at our healthcare service in a different way, in a more preventative manner, that in long term, again, trying to look at post-COVID long term, we need to do more to tackle the health, the poor health of the nation?
Yes, and I think in whatever circumstance we look at, and the government accepts this argument, we've accepted it for many years, and we've taken a number of steps to try to address this. I noticed some of the data and detail that's available on the challenges that individuals will face will be made as a consequence of COVID, will be made worse by other weaknesses in their health and in their fitness. So Mr. Whittle makes a strong argument, as the government accepts, for people to pursue a healthy living approach. Many of our public messages are supportive of that approach, to encourage people to exercise, to look after their health, to take preventative action, to make sure that they are in the strongest possible position to be able to withstand the effects of conditions such as COVID, or for that matter, some other challenging health conditions that they will face in our society. So the emphasis on preventative interventions is a core part of the government's health strategy and will remain so in the future.
Okay, thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Mr. Whittle. Can I bring in John Mason, please?
Thanks very much, Convener. And if I can start off, I mean, a few weeks ago, the numbers in hospital were under 500. And on Tuesday, I think they were 1479. And then yesterday, they were 1537. So they are still rising. And for me, that's the key figure I've been watching kind of day by day. When they are still rising, is it not too early to be relaxing some of the restrictions, like these huge crowds at football and rugby?
It's a very careful judgment, Convener, that has to be established here. And I think Mr. Mason puts a fair and challenging point to me. The situation that we have to consider is a balance of considerations around a number of factors, around the prevalence of the virus, the presence of hospital cases, the pressures on intensive care, and a variety of other social and economic indicators, not least of which the wider well-being of the population and the ability to sustain restrictions and the impact that may have on the mental and economic well-being of individuals. So there is a careful balance to be struck here. And I think, I would hope Mr. Mason would accept from the explanation that the First Minister gave on Tuesday and the explanation I've given today, that the government, whilst hopeful, continues to take a cautious course in the relaxation of restrictions. We are taking a phased approach. I've dealt with a range of broadcast media in the course of this week, where I've been dealing with criticism of the government that we did not go further in the relaxation of measures than we went on Tuesday. And those criticisms have been strongly expressed by a number of sectors, but I would say, and essentially Mr Mason puts the counterpoint to me, that why are you going as fast as you're going? And it's a not unreasonable point. There is a careful balance to be struck. We judge that the larger events, such as in outdoor football stadiums, where vaccine certification and lateral flow device testing is required amongst 50% of the crowds, at least 50% of the crowds, is a reasonable first step in the relaxation of the restrictions to enable some of these events to take their course, whilst we consider whether, with the benefit of another week of data, we can see a wider improvement in the situation that allows us to relax measures further. But I acknowledge it's a careful balance, and it's one the government wrestles with a great deal of consideration.
Okay, I take the point about balance, and I suspect you may be going to give me a similar answer to my next question, which would be about isolation, because we were at 10 days, we're now at 7, I think the United States is at 5. How are we getting the balance, and what's the thinking about, you know, exactly how long that should be?
It's the balance question again. I'm going to invite Professor Leach in a moment to say to give some detail about the clinical justification, because we need to hear that. Ministers have heard that, and we've come to conclusions about that. But I think there is an important perspective here that has to be borne in mind. And it really goes back to, I suppose, many of the questions that we have wrestled with as ministers, and which I've shared with the committee on a number of occasions, around the four harms framework. That there are multiple harms created as a consequence of COVID. Loss of economic well-being is one of them. Loss of social interaction is another. And ministers have to be conscious of those factors when we take decisions around questions such as self-isolation. We've been criticised for taking so long to relax the self-isolation rules. I think we took an appropriate amount of time to make those judgments within the context of the arrangements and the policy approach that we've taken to managing the pandemic. And that, I think, will be an important point in the judgments that we have to apply in the future. But I invite Professor Leach to add some remarks to what I've said in relation to the clinical explanation on the relaxation of self-isolation requirements.
It's a balance, Mr Mason. And we did go from 14 to 10, if you remember, and that's as we learn more about the virus, and it's as we learn more about the risk of the virus in your position you have, not only the state of your pandemic, so the number of cases you have, but also the science you have available to you. So we wouldn't have gone from 10 to 7 without testing, for example. The UKHSA, who are the real boffins here, who do the risk adjustment for us, roughly said 10 days with no testing is about the same risk as 7 days with two tests. So that was a relatively straightforward piece of clinical advice to give to politicians, to say it's not exact, of course, because there are confidence intervals in the statistics, but roughly speaking, moving from 10 days with no tests to 7 days with two tests was about the same risk you were taking. Now, what we now need to know is France and the US have gone to 5 days with testing. So we need to know what is the risk percentage you'd be taking of release of infected cases on day 5. In reality, what the US and France have done has been a little bit misunderstood. What they're doing is actually 5 days of isolation, release on day 6, which is only 1 day less than us. So actually the headline is not quite right. So you would, in France or America, you would test and get released on day 6. We test now and release on day 7 if you're, both your tests are negative. So we don't yet know what that percentage risk would be. And that clearly changes if you've got 15,000 cases or 150 cases. If you've got 150 cases in your community, then your risk can be higher. You can take more risk because you're less likely to meet positive cases. If you've got 15,000 cases, your risk is higher. So it's not only a matter of the percentage risk you'd be taking by release, it's also the number of people you have in your community who are positive. So we will take that UK HSA advice, as will the other 3 UK countries. We will adapt it for our date of our pandemic, and we will give appropriate advice. My instinct right now is we've only just moved from 10 to 7. We need to let that work through in the real world, because the theory is one thing. People actually doing lateral flow tests in houses with kids running around their legs and pets and everything else doesn't really work like it works in the laboratory. So we need to see what happens with 10 to 7 before we would give advice about 7 to what would effectively be 6.
Okay, thanks very much for that. My next point would be concerning vaccine passports. I mean, we heard a lot about them, I think, in September especially, and there was a lot of discussion around them, but we maybe haven't heard so much about them recently. But the suggestion is we might have greater use of them, is that right, moving forward in the next few weeks? And can you confirm as well that if there is a vaccine passport, that a negative test will be, when I say vaccine passport, I realise that the correct term is certificate, would there also be a negative test would be accepted? Thanks.
The Cabinet will consider the steps that we take on any future expansion of the vaccine certification scheme. The vaccine certification scheme works well. I fail to understand what the fuss is about it. I think it's a completely reasonable request for us to make. And the arrangements are in place. It functions well, as I indicated in my response to oral questions in Parliament yesterday, where you have a system involving over 10 million individual vaccinations. There's bound to be teething issues on certain vaccine certificates, and I've made it clear that ministers will help to resolve any issues. Indeed, I had an email last night from a gentleman who's not a constituent of mine looking to for my help to solve a vaccine certification issue, and that is underway this morning. So we will resolve these minor issues when they arise, but the vaccine certification scheme works perfectly well. The Cabinet will consider any future expansion in our discussions on Tuesday. We obviously have put in place steps which enable lateral flow negative lateral flow device tests to be an alternative to vaccine certification. That would remain an option for us to take forward in any future expansion, and the Government will, of course, consider that.
Okay, thanks, Convener. Thanks very much.
Thank you. That concludes our consideration of the item and our time. I'd like to thank the Deputy First Minister and his supporting officials for their attendance this morning. The committee's next meeting will be on the 20th of January, where we will take evidence from the Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for COVID recovery again. That concludes the public part of our meeting this morning. I suspend the meeting to allow the witnesses to leave and members to move on to MS Teams, and I move this meeting into private. Thank you.